Sino ang isasalang natin ngayon sa hot seat? Good evening, I'm your host Kim Bernardo-Lokin, sitting in for Antonio Contreras. Recently, a new scandal hit the Bureau of Customs. This involves the rampant smuggling of alleged substandard steel products. The big steel makers and custom officials were linked to the anomaly. The Bureau promised to cooperate in the investigation of this anomaly. And of course, kaugnay ng isyung yan, makakapanayam natin ngayong gabi si Customs Assistant Commissioner Philip Vincent Maronilla. Welcome to Hot Seat, Assistant Commissioner. Sabi ko nga, pwede ba kitang tawaging ASCOM Jet na lang?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Good evening din po sa lahat ng nanonood yes. na itong programa nyo.
Oh, I'm sure babantayan nila talaga to kasi every time that somebody from the customs will be the guest, talagang consider dapat yung hot seat, di ba?
Sanay na ho tayo sa ganun. Ganun lagi kami.
Okay, so like I said, meron nga naman kayong bagong scandal pero of course it's nothing new sa inyo, no? Let's talk about that, yung substandard na steel. So, ang nangyari, ano na bang nangyari sa investigasyon? Can you update us? Tell us about it.
Well, right now, ang nangyayari is that there are two investigations being conducted by the Bureau of Customs.
Okay, this is dalawa.
This is independent from the investigation being conducted by the Presidential Anti-Corruption Commission.
Okay.
Which we also cooperate with. Mm-hmm. We provided them documents already. Nasabpina na rin kami ng PACC. Ang nag-handle ho yata si Commissioner Manny Luna.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Commissioner Greco Bellica has his own fact-finding also that he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
So, ang tinitingnan namin dito, yung allegation na may mga nakakapasok sa aming substandard steel products.
Yes, oo.
Two ways. Unang-una, dun sa mga malalaking kumpanya na declares it really as it is, but doesn't really...
Misdeclaration yun, di ba?
Misdeclaration or misrepresentation na it is what it is, what is supposed to be.
Yes.
So, pagdating ho doon, titingnan namin yung dokumento nila.
Okay.
And then we'll also look into the process on how the Bureau of Philippine Standards were able to issue certificates of compliance.
That's right, ano? Kasi, it has to have a certificate, di ba?
Yes.
They have to issue that.
Border lang ho kami. The one that certifies that it's actually substandard or not substandard or passes through the Philippine standards is the Department of Trade and Industry, Bureau of Philippine Standards.
Mm-hmm.
Now, once they certify it, of course, the Bureau of Customs is not an expert on it. They're the ones who are experts. Plus, yung proseso yata nila, tinitingnan na yung standard ng quality na itong mga steel products ito. Doon pa lang sa pinanggagalingan. Bago pa makarating dito.
Yes.
Minamarkahan na yan doon.
Correct.
Sabihin na fit yan to be imported for Philippine consumption.
Yes.
So once we see those marks, once we see the papers, the permits, we simply just process it.
Oh, it appears that everything was done
according to the procedure.
Oh.
So yun ang titingnan namin ngayon. We'll verify also with, because there's already allegations that there might be misrepresentations.
Yes.
So we'll call them up.
So how did you know about it? I mean, were you given a tip? Were there complaints? Kasi, of course, iba-iba yung pumapasok sa port, di ba?
Mm.
So, alam ko marami kayong tinitignan talaga. So, how were you alerted on this?
May derogatory information kami nakuha from concerned citizens group.
I see.
We'll keep their names confidential
to protect their security also.
And they provided us with documents. PACC were also provided with the same documents and they coordinated with us also.
Ah, so doon nagsimula. Kasi siguro ASCOM, what we want to hear also is that how dangerous is this substandard steel kasi? And why should we be monitoring them strictly? Especially their entry into the country. Especially in light of, you know, di ba marami tayong typhoon? Earthquake, di ba? So ano ba yung gaano ba kalaki ang danger that this substandard steel poses to us?
Well, the danger is very big. For one, we're undergoing a very extensive build program.
Kaya nga eh. Pero ASCOM, hindi ko pa nakikita masyadong build na yan. So, iisa pa lang siguro build. Antayin natin yung dalawa pa. Okay, go on.
And most of these structures are utilized by the public extensively. Lahat, okay. Karamihan ang itatayo dito. And of course, kinokontrata na, ang nakokontrata dito ay mga private entities that bids for these particular products.
Tama.
Or about projects. Other than, of course, the ones being handled by DPWH, marami pa rin namang
tama.
Private entities na.
Yes. Oh.
And if we don't guard against this importation of substandard steel, baka yung integrity na itong mga structure na ito maapektuhan. E ginagamit
right.
ng general public natin.
Oo. Oh.
Pangalawa, kung titignan mo yung trend, especially sa mga dito sa atin sa Greater Manila area,
mm-hmm.
at the same time, even sa mga malalapit na probinsya natin, ang trend ngayon, siguro dahil mahal na yung lupa at mahal din makapagsimula ng mm-hmm. pamilya, is to actually build structures na pataas. Hindi na flat, wala na masyadong villages.
Karamihan,
condominiums, vertical na yung mga
tinatayo na
struktura. So, again,
diba?
Hundreds and thousands of people, families live in these structures.
So it will endanger so many lives,
yes.
Diba? So ASCOM, one component of this is, of course, I mean, we cannot deny the connivance of some officials. So I'm sure hindi naman nila mapapalusot yung mga yan kung wala silang mga kakausap, kasama. So, how do you deal with it? And how do you catch them? And what do you do to punish them?
Now, that's the second part of our investigation.
Ah, okay. Yan na nga yung sinasabi mo pangalawa. Okay.
Pangalawa, we look at yung proseso naman namin.
Okay.
Internally with us. Pero pwede dun sa unang aspeto kasi, may permits yan galing sa DTI. Pwede
yes,
nila sabihin, sinunod lang nila. Pero dun sa pangalawang scheme, that could be... that would be misdeclaration already. Meaning,
yes.
you say that you're bringing in one type of steel product when you're bringing in ibang type na pala.
Oo nga. Ay, oo. Very, ano yan eh, very common na problem
yes.
yan sa Bureau of Customs.
So, pag binuksan ng mga examiner namin at hindi nila vinerify na, ay, mali yung, hindi yan yung laman. Kung ano yung dineclare nyo, hindi yun ang laman. At wala kayong permit para magparating ng ganyang klaseng steel products. If they're in connivance, they will report another thing.
Mm-hmm.
And they will just confirm what the declaration of the importer is.
So what do you do? How do you deal with it? And what type of penalties or punishment do you do? And how swift is the investigation in these particular cases?
Well, ngayon, we take it case-to-case basis para mabilis.
Uh-uh.
So on one particular transaction, we look at it already.
Mm-hmm.
Our intelligence and enforcement group, together with the ones helping us monitor our ground people, which is the Philippine Coast Guard
yes.
and the Philippine Army,
mm-hmm.
are looking into it already.
Mm-hmm.
So, meron kami mga special operations. In fact, nakita nyo lang, may entrapment na ginawa yung Coast Guard namin just last week.
Mm-hmm.
Because part of the problem is, yun pa rin, bribery.
That's
you,
right.
You bribe... our ground personnel for them yes. to look the other way.
Correct.
And that's a problem that we still are slowly trying to eradicate. And we recognize that it's still there.
That's true. And naitanong ko nga sa inyo, ASCOM, you've been in the Bureau for how many years already?
Nine years.
Meron ka ba nakitang improvement? Can there be anything done at all para medyo mabawasan naman yung rango ninyo na number one or number two sa most corrupt in terms of government agencies?
Alam mo, to be fair, ma'am, when Commissioner Guerrero went in, sabi nga niya, tinignan niya muna ano ba talaga tong ahensya to kasi nagulat din siya nung in-appoint siya. But yung impression niya, pareho ng impression ng ibang commissioners that...
Which is?
Na may magagawa ka. May, mm-hmm. may improvement na nangyayari every time. And
is it a significant improvement, do you think, ASCOM?
Well, each commissioner, I can say that each commissioner that passes has provided at least one significant improvement.
I see.
Towards a step to a better customs.
Yes.
But the thing is, yung susunod na commissioner, kailangan niya ma-recognize yung significant step ng predecessor niya.
Mm-hmm.
At kailangan ipagpatuloy niya yun.
Mm-hmm.
Kaya ngayon, ang ginawa ni Commissioner Guerrero, nireview namin lahat ulit. At yung mga nagawa na namin, we marked it as our achievement already. Kasi mm-hmm. Hindi nare-recognize eh.
Mm-hmm.
And then we entered into the performance governance system.
Okay.
It is like an ISO program mm-hmm. for government performance. So, nag-revalida po kami. We went through the initiation stage. There are several stages.
Mm-hmm.
And when we go through all these stages, ma-institutionalize namin yung reform program namin.
Yes.
Meron kaming strategic plan na kailangan naming sundin. And when we presented it to a panel of private individuals, members, which have been dedicating their lives into the pursuit of good governance.
Yes.
They actually provided us with an award last week, a Trailblazer Award.
Given by
the performance governance system.
Oh, okay. That's something new.
That's something new. That's very rare. That's not given to any government agency.
And not especially customs.
Not especially customs. That's why we really aimed for it because we wanted to send a signal that we're really serious about this. And we will see this through.
Actually, that's good to hear kasi ang impression ng ating mga kababayan, of course, is that number one, if there's any chance of being appointed or getting into whichever government agency, gusto nila sa customs. Uh-huh. Hindi dahil sa, well, dun sa mga extra perks that they believe na makukuha nila. So, yun yung, I think that's also part of what you need to remove. Yung perception ng tao sa inyo, hindi ba? So, recently, Associate Commissioner, the President, had declared na meron siyang mga sisibakin din, di ba? Or yung mga sabi ni Pangulong Duterte, 100 empleyado. Totoo ba yan?
Totoo.
Ang sisibakin? Ano ba nangyari dito? At ano bang nangyari? Sasampahan ba sila ng kaso? Tinanggal ba sila? Ano ba ito?
Nasampahan sila ng kaso sa Office of the Ombudsman. They've been placed on a floating status already.
Mm-hmm.
I think about more than 10 of them, the ombudsman has already decided and dismissed them from service.
I see.
All others are awaiting for the resolution of their cases before the Office of the Ombudsman.
I see.
Lahat po na may pending administrative case internally with the Bureau, we pass it on to the Office of the Ombudsman.
I see.
As per directive of the President. Hinarap pa po ng Pangulo itong mga to.
That's right.
Napagsabihan nila.
Oo nga.
Napagsabihan niya yung mga taong to.
Nagalit nga siya, sinermonan niya, hindi ba?
Totoo. But to be fair with the President, he observed due process still.
Okay. Sige. Okay. Kaugnay niyan, di ba? Hindi ba dapat marami nagpapanukala na dapat merong lifestyle check, continuous lifestyle check. Pero bago mo sagutin yan, ASCOM, magbabalik po kami, dyan lamang po kayo.
Hi everyone, I am Ziher Basho and welcome to the new Clark City where the 30th Southeast Asian Games will be held this November. Dito gaganapin ang tagisan ng mga atleta mula sa iba't ibang bansa ng Southeast Asian region.
Good evening and welcome back to the Hot Seat. Our guest this evening is the Customs Assistant Commissioner Philip Vincent Maronilla. So tama ba 'yon? Hindi ko ba narambol ang pangalan mo, ASCOM? Tama ba? Okay, so ASCOM Jet na lang, that's easier to say. So I think the question that was hanging earlier is the question on lifestyle check. So ang tanong diyan, sumasa ilalim pa rin ba hanggang ngayon? Is it a continuing process that you do a lifestyle check on your employees, your officials, and meron bang nangyayari dito? Meron bang fruit itong endeavor na ito?
kami po sa Bureau of Customs, so sa Bureau of Internal Revenue, meron nung isang ahensya sa Department of Finance that does regular lifestyle checks on all our personnel. It's the Revenue Integrity Protection Service.
Oh, yes. RIPS, yes. Yes.
Bukod po doon, ang Office of the Ombudsman, we also submit to them our statement of assets and liabilities and net worth.
Sure.
And they profile it, and may ilan-ilan na rin sa amin na lifestyle check na rin under the Office of the Ombudsman. And this is a welcome development for us because this is a process that I think we all need to go through.
So, you think, kasi matagal na yan, this is nothing new eh. Matagal na yan, every administration would actually propose a lifestyle check. Kasi we would hear stories before of middle-ranking or low-ranking employee with beautiful cars, for example. Mamahaling relo, di ba? Parang di naman yata tama yun, di ba? So, and those are pretty much glaring, you know, kita mo, in your face yan eh, di ba? Do you have any mechanisms right now that would help deter these kinds of practices by your employees, officials?
Yes, we are actually building an internal division, an ad hoc division until the executive order is approved by the president.
Yes,
which will guard against those kinds of things.
I see.
And will maintain the integrity of the officers and the personnel of the Bureau of Customs.
Mm-hmm.
It's a revised internal inquiry and investigation division.
That's good. Yes. That's welcome.
Meron naman po kami ngayon, internal inquiry, but part of it, magkakaroon na siya ng integrity check.
Which means?
Which means that kami mismo will check, will police our own ranks.
You mean that wala yan. It's not part of what you had, you know, the regular process that you go through.
Dati, meron kami internal affairs service, yung internal inquiry and prosecution division.
Mm-hmm.
But those that division only caters to complaints filed against our personnel. So more than that, this particular new office now will be more proactive. Even
so,
without complaints,
pwede silang
even without complaints, they can check and look into regular activities of our personnel.
Okay.
They'll also look into the processes na po pwedeng maging open for corruption and recommend if needed reforms in the processes should be done already.
Oo, kasi ASCOM, hindi naman siguro lingid sa ating lahat, di ba? Alam mo, yung mga words na Tara System,
yes.
Yung mga ganyan, alam natin yun, it's very common, eh,
yes.
Di ba? And very few naman ang magre-reklamo, di ba? Whether ikaw yung importer, di ba? Or whether kung ano man yung ginagawa mo doon, you have your business with the Bureau of Customs, kasi natatakot ka rin, nabalikan ka ng mga tao sa Bureau of Customs.
Mm.
So, it's a vicious cycle actually, di ba?
Mm.
So, at least now you're doing something to try to stop it?
Yes. At the same time, we're talking to our stakeholders also.
Mm.
Because sabi nga ni Commissioner Guerrero, yung corruption sa Bureau of Customs, hindi naman yan yung mga tao lang namin eh.
It takes two to
yes,
tango.
Our
That's
stakeholders
true.
Must also reform themselves.
Yes.
Ibig sabihin, meron naman kaming mga organization na mga stakeholders namin na kinakausap namin, and they must police their own ranks also.
Oo, that's true. But you can only do so much,
yes.
Di ba? So, like we said, it takes two to tango nga.
Minsan, ayaw ng tao namin. Iipitin nila dahil ireklamo.
Oo nga, no? Tama.
Tapos sabihin nila, hindi, hinihingan kami niyan kasi gusto ng ganito. Wala naman hinihingi.
Si-set up nila yung tao.
Si-set up nila yung tao namin. So, instead of actually trying to do his work again the next time around, tanggapin na lang niya yung binibigay nung ano kaysa maistorbo din siya, di ba?
Oo nga. So, there are also nuances, ano? Different
yes.
To that.
Yes.
Okay, so yung mga suggestions, kasi every year, kapag nagsusona ang Pangulo sa State of the Nation, wala siyang masyadong magandang sasabihin.
Superstar kami lagi.
Oo, pagka sa inyo na, hindi ba? So, marami, of course, panukala, di ba? One of them is yung ibalik natin yung Societe Generale, di ba? Or SGS, di ba?
Yes.
Which used to be there so many years back, di ba?
Yeah.
Oo, and then it was removed. Ngayon, sinasabi mo, before we started actually the show, that there was actually a reason behind this. So, ituro mo nga sa akin or sabihin nyo nga sa amin kung ano ang proseso. Bakit siya natanggal before and it was a precondition to the GATT WTO?
It was an effect of our entrance to the GATT WTO
I
system.
See.
Dati kasi, tayo yung nagsasabi kung ano yung yung basis ng duties na i-impose natin.
Okay.
So nagkaroon tayo ng home consumption value, and then nagkaroon ng SGS value. Mm-hmm. And we use the SGS as a pre-shipment tool,
yes.
An accredited surveyor for pre-shipment inspection. At the same time, they're also the ones who provide us with data on the current values of goods. At ito yung basis natin. When we entered into the WTO, ang in-adopt all over the world by WTO members is what we call the transaction value system.
Which means
what the price paid or payable for the goods would be the basis for the duties that you will impose.
Yes. Diba?
So, hindi mo na pwedeng gamitin si SGS ngayon kasi commercial invoice lang. Mm-hmm. Yun ang dapat basihan mo eh. So, yung unang aspeto ng trabaho niya ngayon, nawala na. So, we did not need them anymore. Tapos, yung pre-shipment surveying naman niya, na ginagamit natin for valuation and classification purposes, pinagbawal din sa WTO. Nagkaroon tayo ng WTO agreement on pre-shipment inspection at sinasabi doon, ang pwede lang mga pre-shipment inspection ay halos lahat, wag lang nagagamitin siya sa valuation and classification.
Mm-hmm.
So ngayon, meron kaming pre-shipment inspection naman sa bulk and break bulk, hindi dun sa containerized. Ha?
Okay.
Dun sa mga bulk and break bulk. Only to determine the quality and quantity of goods.
I see.
But we can't use the survey report in terms of, let's say, for example, valuing or classifying the goods for tax purposes.
But, you know, Associate Commissioner, they were saying na simula nung tinanggal niyo yung SGS na yan, mas lalong naging rampant yung smuggling. That's what they were saying. Kasi, syempre, tinanggal mo yung process na yan, so ngayon, mas nagiging creative dahil yung mga tao ang, you're leaving them with room to play, so ika nga. So do you think that also happened, and did it made corruption increase in the bureau?
That's a factor. I think there's some truth into it.
Yes.
But you have to realize that the truth of the matter is we opened ourselves to the world, and every time you open yourself to globalization, the influx of goods that is being brought to your country is so much. Mm-hmm. Nadami eh, kasi open economy ka nga eh, diba? May duties and taxes ka, pero in-open mo ngayon yung purpose ng GATT WTO, eh, diba?
That's right.
To globalize the economy of the member countries. And ang consequence talaga nun is that you should have strengthened our border protection capabilities.
So in other words, hindi tayo handa?
Actually, may mga ilang taon naman na, yung to be fair dun sa mga nag-craft nung batas para pumasok tayo, nagbigay sila ng safety net provisions ng ilang taon. Ang nangyari lang sa gobyerno natin, mukhang hindi natin napaghandaan yung gantong sitwasyon ngayon. Ilang taon na rin naman tayong nakapag-enter sa GATT WTO.
That's correct.
Yun ang mga unang taon naman na handle natin. But of course, because of the progress of that particular agreement, talaga magbubuka yung ekonomiya mo. Now, ngayon, hindi lang GATT WTO ang free trade agreement. There are other more liberal free trade agreements that the country has entered into. Several with other countries, one of which is China, which is our biggest trading partner.
Yes, now, as of the
moment,
yes.
If you're not prepared to do your border protection capability at the advent of this opening of your borders to the influx of these goods, talaga hong i-open mo yung sarili mo to smuggling.
Pero nakakalungkot naman yan, Associate Commissioner. Ang ibig ba sabihin yan, we are limited as we are right now, and wala na tayo masyadong magagawa because of this, kasi parang overtaken by events tayo dahil hindi tayo handa eh.
Hindi yung totoo yun. Ang naging problema natin, hindi lang sa hindi tayo handa, hindi natin na-realize kung ano yung consequences nun.
Right, yes.
Right now, we have that realization already.
Mm-hmm.
I think experience has already taught us na ito talaga yung mangyayari. At mangyayari to. Mm-hmm. At lalaki tong gantong sitwasyon. O pagdating pa ng mga panahon, we're negotiating now and we've concluded negotiations. Itina-ratify nila yung pinakamalaking free trade agreement sa buong mundo.
Oh, okay.
Consisting of 16 countries, kasama tayo dun. Represents about $4 billion of GDP.
Mm-hmm.
So that's it comprises about 30 to 40% of the world's trade.
Wow, yung grupo lang na yun, diba?
So if that is signed again, that's going to open up again our economy to an influx of goods
more,
from these countries more. And ngayon, mas may pagplano tayo sa experience na yan. Kaya ngayon, may mga modern X-ray devices
so,
na kami.
So, proactive na kayo
proactive
ngayon.
Na
mas proactive
ngayon.
Kayo ngayon. So, another issue that we discussed earlier was the issue on the, well, the new rice tarification law,
yes.
Di ba? So, we'll discuss the impact of that and then ano yung mga ginagawa nating measures ngayon kasi back and forth tayo on that law, no? But please answer that later. We'll just go on a break. The hot seat will be right back. Stay with us.
Mga isyung pinag-uusapan, mga palitang laman ng pahayagan, impormasyong dapat niyong malaman, tatalakayin, bubusisiin, at hihimayin ni Mario Garcia kasama ang kanyang mga panauhin sa harap ng bayan. Face Off!
Welcome back to the Hot Seat. Our guest for tonight is the Customs Assistant Commissioner Philip Vincent Maronilla. Well, sir, nandito na tayo sa rice tarification issue, di ba? So, this has been a very controversial measure because it's already passed into law, pero yung inaasahan nila na dapat eh mangyayari that this law would hopefully solve the problems that, you know, it saw before, hindi rin nangyari. So, what's your take on this?
I think medyo nabigla lang tayo dun sa pag-implement natin ng rice tarification law.
Mm-hmm. Why is that?
Well, I'll from what I was looking at, we were able to tarify it, but you have to remember also na yung tariff rate natin dito, na bigay na rin na sa concession natin nung nag-enter tayo ng free trade agreement sa ASEAN.
Yung tawag
natin ASEAN
yes,
Trade and Goods Agreement.
Yes.
So, ang pag meron kang certificate of origin galing sa mga bansa na members nito.
Na ASEAN member
ASEAN
countries.
Members,
yeah.
Eh, alam naman natin ang Vietnam, Thailand, at Cambodia.
Which is where we import the most, the bulk of our
yes,
rice.
Our members of ASEAN.
Uh-oh.
And pag ito naman, yung mga bansang to ay nag-issue na certificate of origin, ang tarifa natin 35%.
Mm-hmm.
So we wanted to control the tariff of the rice products. But limited din yung capability natin i-tarify ng masyadong mataas pagdating dito sa mga bansang to. Eh,
correct.
Bulk nga siya nandun.
Oo, yes.
So, I think, ano lang yan eh, birth pains.
Mm-hmm.
Kasi nag-implement ka ng bagong batas. For the longest time, we were at a quota regime. Sabihin, nakokontrol natin yung quota natin.
Oh,
pero
well,
ngayon, hindi na pwede.
Oo nga.
Nga,
actually, tinanggal mo yung quota, hindi ba? Oo. So, I mean, nung tinanggal mo, supposedly, it is to address a continuing problem
yes.
before. Which naman, in turn, created another problem for us, di ba?
But you also have to understand that yung pagtanggal ng quota system natin is not a unilateral decision. Meaning, it's not a decision that the government just arrived at overnight. Nung pumasok ulit tayo sa WTO,
mm-hmm.
Ang pinili na nating sistema was to tarify.
I see.
But we wanted to give our farmers some time to adjust.
Yes.
And ihanda yung agriculture industry natin sa influx na to.
Yes.
We knew all along that eventually we will have to tarify.
Mm-hmm.
But we wanted...
They probably didn't know that, ASCOM. Siguro yung mga bureaucrats lang nakakaintindi
yes,
yun, di ba?
I'm pretty sure that our bureaucrats know.
Dahil yung, when you talk about that, especially sa agri, my God, you know, ang sabi nga nila sa probinsya, you know, rice, you know, it's dead. Our farmers don't have any more incentive to plant rice, di ba? And ngayon nga, sinasabi mo sa akin, may bago na naman kayong huli. Ngayon naman, sibuyas naman,
yes,
di ba?
Yes, mayroon kami maya-maya lang sa Manila International Container Port, may mga agricultural products kami.
Agricultural products na naman. So, pinapatay talaga yung agriculture natin, di ba? Yung mga yan, ang farmers natin ang nahihirapan dyan. But of course, that's not your purview, di ba?
Yes.
Yung sa tarification naman, yun na nga. Di ba? Sabi nga nila, paano ngayon yan? So, did we see a significant improvement though since the time that the rice tarification law was passed?
Dumami yung importation, of course. Pero dumami din naman yung na-collecta namin for sa tinatawag nating ACEF.
What's ACEF?
It's a fund that goes through the development of our farmers and agricultural industry.
Ah, okay. So a certain portion of the levy goes to that.
10 billion na yata yung na-collecta namin for that.
And sino ngayon na naghahawak ng pondo na yun?
It should be handled by the Department of Agriculture.
I see. So yun naman to help mitigate yung effects.
Bigyan sila ng mga equipments, pautangin sila.
Equipment para saan eh? Wala na nga. Di mo nga pwedeng labanan yung presyo ng, let's say, Vietnam.
You know why hindi mo sila pwedeng labanan? Kasi because of the equipments that they use. Mm-hmm. Very mechanical na yung ginagamit nila. May mga machines sila na mabilis magpa-dry ng palay para ma-convert kagad into bigas. Tayo, nagbibilad pa rin tayo sa kalsada.
Those kinds
of machines are needed to support our agriculture.
I see. So, hopefully, with that fund,
mabalansin
it will
natin.
Help. Oo, mababalansin natin. Okay, so meron pa. Ano pa ba ito? Isa pa daw na mainit na kontrobersya din sa customs. Palagi naman mainit eh, lahat ng issue sa customs. Askom eh, yung panukalang brokerless option. Mm. So, para sa mga importer, pwede na daw wala ng customs broker, sabi nila. Bakit ito pinag-iisipan o ginagawa ng gobyerno? Labag ba ito sa Customs Broker Act of 2004? So, tell us about, you know, ano ba yung reason behind that?
Well, ang latest law namin, yung Customs Modernization and Tariff Act, allows for it.
Ah, okay.
Mas later law yon kaysa sa Customs Brokers Act.
Oo.
We do recognize that customs brokerage is a profession.
Yes.
That's regulated by the Professional Regulations Agency in the country. But at the same time, if you look at more progressive customs authorities, may option naman whether they would secure the services of a customs broker or if the transaction is very familiar with them. The company can just nominate their own people, their officers, to directly transact with the Bureau of Customs.
Ah, pwedeng diretso. Pwedeng diretso. To liaise, ano?
Yes.
From their own company.
Yes. Ang gusto lang naman namin, i-provide yung option na yun sa mga importers natin.
I see. And is this a common practice worldwide?
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. Ngayon, kung pinangangambahan ng mga customs brokers natin.
That they'll be out of business.
Oh, hindi naman siguro. I mean, companies who want to exercise due diligence will always have a need for customs brokers.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, yung mga kumpanya na maliliit, small and medium enterprises that we try to promote, that thrives into these kinds of importations of raw materials, that is not really big and are trying to cut costs, will have the option of actually just learning the process in the Bureau of Customs, which is a little bit... Ano naman, madali naman pag yung mga regular items na ipinaparating.
So, is there a process of accreditation or at least basic training for this?
Yes, there is a registration process and our training division is open and they can just go there and if they want a crash course on how to go about processing your own shipments to the bureau, they'll be given a crash course.
Oo, siguro kung ganyan, ASCOM, there should be a more thorough information campaign.
Yes.
Kasi ang nangyayari, syempre, kung maririnig namin yan, what do you mean by that, di ba? Ako, I do not represent the brokers, di ba? But with this option, syempre, it puts a big question mark in the minds of people, especially the ordinary ones who do not know the process in customs, di ba?
Fine-tune lang ho namin yung regulation namin dito. We want to make it as simple as possible so that when lay people read it, they'll have confidence of actually saying, mukhang kaya ko to.
Mm-hmm.
Punta ako sa bureau, tanungin ko lang sila ano yung kailangan dito. And maybe try for themselves. Para naman ho, medyo makabawas din sa gastos.
Hindi naman exactly open ang Bureau of Customs sa ganyan. I mean, pag pumunta ka doon, tatanong mo nga lang kung saan yung opisina ni ganito. Abutin ka ng 30 minutes bago siguro may magsabi sa'yo kung nasaan, di ba? So,
ma'am, iba na rin ngayon. Meron na kaming very active na customer care portal system.
Totoo?
Meron na rin ho kaming BOC care system.
Galing ako dyan na nagtanong kami, may sinamaan kami.
Years back yan, ma'am, no?
Ganun ba? Isang taon at kalahati.
May iba na ma'am, ni-revise ni si Commissioner Guerrero is very very customer service oriented.
Yes.
So, ni-strengthen niya yung BOC care system namin. Nag-create siya ng customer care portal system namin. Meron po kaming text hotline, 8484, if everyone wants to bring in their complaints. Mm-hmm. It's going to be treated confidentially.
Or even questions.
Queries that are going to be addressed to the 8484. Kasi anti-corruption hotline po yan.
Yes.
Ipapasa po namin yan sa aming customer care para magkapag-reply po sa inyo.
Oh, okay. So that's good. Yes. You have installed actually these mechanisms where you can answer them directly,
yes,
di ba? So at least, yun, kasama yan sa proactive na sinasabi mo.
Saka ma'am, for this Christmas season, they can go to our website and meron kaming balikbayan box and parcel tracker. So they key in yung tracking number na binigay sa kanila ng mga LBC at kung sino yung mga consolidators nila, real time makikita nila yung processing mismo nung.
Oh, okay. So that's good to know, especially ngayon dahil ang laki na ngayon ng jump ng mga online purchases,
yes,
hindi ba?
E-commerce ang tawag.
Oh, e-commerce, correct. Okay, so we'll talk about that and other priorities that the Bureau of Customs under General Guerrero would have to implement, di ba? Or at least yung wish list. So, you'll answer that after the break. So we'll be back after this break. Please stay with us. Good evening and welcome back to Hot Seat. Our guest for tonight, and this is our last leg in our episode for tonight, we still have our Associate Commissioner for the Bureau of Customs, Philip Vincent Maronilla. I know, ASCOM, that you had been answering texts. Alam ko, tinatawagan ka na ng iyong commissioner, di ba? So, sabihin mo kay Commissioner Guerrero, sandali na lang, konti na lang. Because the question earlier was, ano ba yung priorities? And especially in light of all of these, di ba? So, tell us about it. What can we expect now? What will be his priorities? What are directives that were given to you by the president? And how are you going to implement all of this?
Well, the directive of the president is simple. Stop corruption and try to increase.
That's simple, but it's hard.
Yes.
Hard to do. Okay.
Very hard. Now, we've set a 10-point priority program for 2019 alone. And binabantayan yan kung ano na yung level of nasa na siya ngayon. Natapos na ba? Ilang percentage na ba siya? Some of which includes the welfare of our personnel. Majority of which, and I think the most critical of which is the automation project,
okay,
of the Bureau.
Which part are you now in terms of automation?
We're actually trying to rehaul the entire custom system,
mm-hmm,
to make it more efficient, more friendly with our stakeholders.
Mm-hmm.
It would also cater to our two other functions, which is there should be functionalities for our border protection.
Right.
And of course, monitoring of our revenue collection. At the same time, dapat trade facilitating yung system.
Oo, nako, very lofty yung parang dreams yata yan. Goals ba yan? Dreams, bucket list ni General?
Magaling naman yung bago naming Deputy Commissioner for MISTG. It's really a techie guy, si Deputy Commissioner Alan Geronimo.
Oo, so medyo
he knows what he's doing.
Oh, okay.
And kudos also to the previous Deputy Commissioner who handled it, si Deputy Commissioner Jeff D., who was also one of the good IT, one of the better IT guys from the private sector who started the whole program. Pero habang ginagawa namin to, na-address din namin yung mga problema namin sa current system namin. Downtime, mabagal. So, nagkaroon kami ng stabilization program sa current system habang ni-rehaul namin yung
Do you have a timetable for this?
The commissioner wants the whole customs system rehauled hopefully by next year.
When you say next year, end of next year. Eh, yung sinasabi mong 10-point agenda na yung goal ninyo.
Ah, yun ngayon.
For 2019, December na tayo ngayon.
For 2019, na-purchase na naman namin yun.
Oo. Which,
na-purchase na namin yun. Nakuha na namin yung ETM stabilization namin, which is that's the goal for 2019. Mm-hmm. We wanted to hire additional 1,000 personnel.
May tinanggal kayong 100?
Oh, ano na naman kami, nasa 850 na kami.
And I see.
For December, we're hiring another 150. So, madadagdagan yung personnel namin. Kasi, we're only working at less than 50% personnel manpower.
Really?
Doon sa dapat regular plantilla namin. Mm-hmm. Ang regular plantilla position namin is about 6,100.
So, why is it so?
Nabanggit niyo kanina, yung pagpasok sa Bureau of Customs, parang politike, di ba? Mm-hmm. Kailangan na may ganito, may backer ka kay ganito.
Yun na nga eh. Oo.
At ang goal ng mga tao, hindi naman talaga magtrabaho.
Yes.
We wanted to
gusto nila magtrabaho for their own benefit lang.
So ngayon, merit-based system kami.
Oo.
Meron kaming exam na kailangan mong pagdaanan na vinet ng civil service.
Okay.
At talagang pinaghirapan namin. Medyo mahirap-hirap siya. Technically, you really have to be technically sound and may integrity part yung exam na yun. You have to go through a very rigorous interview process.
I see.
And of course, yung final selection ni Commissioner. Kung hindi ka papasa ng exam, very transparent yung exam namin eh. So walang pwedeng tumawag sabihin, ipasa mo yan.
Otherwise, that's good to hear actually, Ascom. Kasi
pinapublish namin yun eh. Mga galit yung mga tao, nakapasa talaga, ba't bigla nakasingit to, di ba? How do we answer that?
Oo, tama. So, kasi I remember before ha, it's very common na, sa customs ka nagtatrabaho, sino nagpasok sa'yo? Yun, hindi ba? So hopefully matatanggal na yun.
And I'm sure, ma'am, during your time sa...
Bakit nakangiti ka, Ascom?
Sa House of Rep. Kasi minsan may lalapit. Ma'am, baka pwede hingin ng endorsement papuntang customs.
Correct.
May mga ganun eh.
May mga ganun. That's actually the norm. More than the exception,
than
that
the
used
exception.
To be the norm, di ba?
Yes, ma'am.
So, namumula ka pala pagka mga ganyan ang pinag-uusapan. Okay, final topic that we need to discuss. Tapos na yung 2019, di ba? Looking at 2020, you talked about automation. What do you think are more high-impact projects that under your present Customs Commissioner, General Guerrero, can do to help erase man lang or, you know, bawasan man lang yung perception that the Bureau of Customs is the most corrupt agency in the country?
Other than modernizing our entire system, which
yes.
will provide us now the tools to actually perform our jobs better, we want to be exempted sa salary standardization law.
Okay.
I know it's not an excuse na gagawa ka ng kalokohan kasi mababa yung sweldo mo. Because after all, you're in public service. Diba?
Yes.
Kung ayaw mo na mababang sweldo, di huwag kang magsilbi sa gobyerno.
Tama.
Pero madidi naman ho siguro na hindi din namin alagaan yung welfare ng mga tao namin. You know, in other customs authorities,
mm-hmm.
they have a very strict reward and punishment system. Mm-hmm. And we want to implement that in the Philippines as well.
You mean you want to adopt best practices
yes.
that we see worldwide,
yes.
diba?
So, mabilis ka matanggal sa trabaho, pero bibigyan ka namin ng magandang benefits.
Incentive when you...
May incentive ka pag nakakollect na exceed mo yung target mo. Yung sweldo mo is enough for you to provide 3 meals a day to your family, pag-aralin yung mga anak mo, and put a roof over their head. Nang wala kang excuse para mangotong or do extracurricular activities to the detriment of the public. And because wala kang reason, mas mahigpit din yung punishment mo kapag gumawa ka ng ganito.
Oo nga, tama yon actually. So, these measures you're putting in place already right
yes,
now?
Yes, we're putting that in place already now. And we're asking Congress to help us in actually exempting us from the salary standardization law.
And
bukod po doon, we want at least 1% of our entire collection to be the budget of the Bureau. Parang ma-improve din namin yung aming mga facilities.
Oo nga, no? Mm-hmm. Bakit? Ano ba yung existing ngayon?
Kung ano yung ma-propose namin, babawasan.
Hindi mag-propose kayo ng mas malaki ng content, di ba?
Medyo naiintindihan din ho namin yung gobyerno natin, talagang may cost-cutting measures din. Eh. Hindi naman ho namin. Pero at least kung mabibigay lang ho sa amin yung 1% man lang ng total na nakokolekta namin, ang dami ho namin mabibiling mga kagamitan at ang dami namin may improve ng facilities namin.
So, ibig sabihin nun, have you reached your goal, yung collection goal ninyo sa ano?
Short ho kami ng konting-konti.
Konting when you say konting-konte, what is that?
Kasi may mga factors din ho na pumasok ngayon taon na medyo nagulat kami. Like for example, 10 billion of our target was supposed to come from the results of the implementation of the fuel marking program.
Okay.
Hindi po na-implement ngayon taon yun.
Ah, okay.
Next year po siya may implement. Pero hindi na ho namin binalik yung 10 billion na target namin because we wanted to try to collect as much to help the government. And of course, there's a trend of the dipping of some of the high value goods that are being imported, where we get our duties and taxes from. So all in all, we're short by about 15-16 billion.
Mm-hmm. So how much was the actual collection now to date? Would you know?
Month to date po siguro nasa mga 580 billion na kami.
580
billion. And we're set to collect more for this month, mga an additional 60 billion for this month. So kung ang gusto sana namin ang short, kung magkaka shortfall talaga, shortfall namin mga less than as a single digit lang na percentage ng shortfall. And then from year versus year, we achieve a double-digit growth.
Oh,
but of course, the goal is to really reach the target.
Because
we reached it last year.
You did naman last year.
Yes,
oh,
we exceeded it even.
Ah, okay. What was the target last year?
Last year, it's 584 po yata. 589 po yata yung nakolekta namin.
Oh, okay, so katulad niyan, we wish you well. Magpapasko na na ngayon, di ba? So medyo mas malaki ang expectation ninyo kasi Christmas time eh.
Yes,
so mas marami tayong hopefully na
imports.
Imports and hopefully mas konti yung ating shortfall,
yes,
di ba? So we wish you well. Napakahirap ng trabaho mo, Associate Commissioner.
Thank you, ma'am.
And very vital, like I said. But we wish you well, and please do inform us next time again of any developments,
yes,
in the
ma'am.
Bureau of Customs.
Thank you also for inviting us and letting us explain our side on the issues.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Hayaan mo next time naman si General Guerrero naman. Okay.
I'm sure he would like it, ma'am.
Okay, so we'll do that. So maraming salamat again sa ating guest for tonight, Customs Assistant Commissioner Philip Vincent Maronilla. Dito po nagtatapos ang ating episode ng Hot Seat. I'm your host, Kim Bernardo-Lokin. Magbabalik po ang Hot Seat next week. Until then, good night.
Yeah.